All right. Thank you, everybody who's listening in. Today, the topic that we're going to be presenting on is titled, What to Expect When You're Expecting a Site Launch. So we're going to be talking about new website launches today. To get started out, we'll do a quick introductions.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Pugh. I am a digital marketing strategist at Something Digital. I work on the creative team, and I do digital marketing for a bunch of different clients, from nonprofit to e-commerce. I, of course, am very passionate about data analysis, as it's a big part of what I do, along with good UX and creative content marketing. I often write for the SD Insights blog, sometimes other blogs, and I will occasionally be a part of Something Digital's office hours.
And I'm Max Chadwick. So my role here is I'm the technical lead for the strategic engagement group here at Something Digital. Our team supports our clients' websites post-launch in an ongoing fashion. And I'm overseeing the work that we're doing. Similar to Lindsay, I also write on the SD Insights blog. I also have my own blog at maxchadwick.xyz, which you can check out. It's a little bit technical, but you might find it interesting. And again, also like Lindsay, I also participate in the Office Hours biweekly web stream.
So if you are not familiar, we want to give you a little bit of background on Something Digital. We are an interactive agency that specializes in e-commerce, website design, digital marketing, and user experience. We are a full-service boutique. We can do everything from create your vision, provide a concept, and launch your website. We've been around for a while, since 1999, and we like to say that we are a unique place where everyone excels and gets invited to dinner. And our dinners, if you've ever attended one, are pretty epic. So if you get an invite, definitely accept. Even if you're tired or don't feel like it, it's always worth it.
So quickly before we dive into things, as we were planning the content for this webinar, one thing we realized is that if you're attending this, you may be in one of two different positions. There's a chance that you have an existing website and you are rebuilding it. And there's also a chance that you are doing a completely net new website for a new brand or something else like that. And the content that we're going to be presenting today is applicable to you no matter which point of view you're coming from. So just wanted to get that out there before we get started.
And before we start, we want to just give you a brief rundown of the agenda for today's webinar. We are first going to talk about why you should launch a new site. So we want to give you some good, legitimate reasons why you might want to launch a new website, why you shouldn't launch a new website. If you're maybe someone who is still in the decision-making phase, and we can save you from potentially making a bad decision or a not completely thought-out decision, we want to give you some content to utilize. And we also want to let you know what you can expect if you've already decided that you're going to launch a new website and now you're in a position to take that live. We definitely want to give you some good content so that you know what to expect after your site goes live.
So why should you launch a new website? One of the first things that comes to mind is changing technologies and trends. We have a list here of a few different things. These are some acronyms and some buzzwords, but we're going to go through them. RWD, this stands for responsive web design. So this was a trend that emerged probably around 2010 when mobile devices and tablets and different screen sizes were beginning to proliferate amongst users and consumers. And before this, websites were typically built assuming that the user would have, you know, a fixed screen size, most likely on a desktop computer. And people started to see mobile devices coming out and started building MDOT websites, specific mobile websites, and that kind of went in a bad direction. All of a sudden, people had to manage two different websites. They had to update content in different places, change code in two different places. And responsive web design emerged to solve that problem. So the idea was you would build one website and it would automatically resize and fit onto any screen size that you were looking at. That was a while ago. More recently, a new trend called PWAs, or progressive web apps, is emerging, and this is becoming a new consumer expectation. So the idea behind it is that the website that you're on behaves more like a native app. So it loads extremely quickly. It has, you know, kind of transitions in between the different screens that you're looking at. It should support offline usage. So if it's e-commerce and you are on a train and you go into a tunnel, you should still be able to browse, and certain actions that need to be online, like adding a product to your cart, should be queued and handled later when you come back online. And the future of this is augmented reality and virtual reality. And voice search is also becoming very big. More and more users we're seeing are using their voice, you know, voice assistants like Siri to get tasks done on their phones, or things like an Alexa in their homes to transact with. So the trends are constantly changing, especially if you're, you know, in that camp where you're looking to build a new site. One of the reasons might be that these new trends have been coming out, and your current existing website is not serving your users correctly with these new expectations.
So we want to give you an example of something that we did for somethingdigital.com. We had an old site that was on Sitecore, and we decided that it was time for us to do a UI refresh. We had, you know, felt that our site was a little bit outdated, and we had also noticed through looking at analytics that there were some parts of the site that users were potentially having issues with. So we took all of those things into consideration, and we decided to build our new website on WordPress. And with the new site, we included a bunch of additional features that we determined would be most useful for our users. Some of those are the addition of video content, some animations throughout the site. We now have filtering and sorting available on a lot of different pages, so you can filter and sort by category or topic for our blog posts. And we also have a new card layout and a sticky header and navigation. And if you're curious just to see what our old site looked like and to take stock of the new changes that we made, you can check it out on Internet Archive to see what it used to look like, and then you can check it out at somethingdigital.com to see these new features. And then another reason why you might want to launch a new site, it's kind of a no-brainer. If you are a completely new brand, you're just getting ready to launch your new brand, you obviously need a website to go along with it. So we've pulled an example from a recent site launch that we did. It's a brand called Riley, and they say that they are for those with champagne taste on a rosé budget. They're bedding, luxury bedding, but at a reasonable price point. And this is their first venture into e-commerce and commerce in general for the brand. So they needed a new site to launch with the launch of the brand. So kind of a no-brainer, but it is important to note that it's the only thing that their brand has to go by right now. It's just the website. The website is the brand. So it's really important to put time into the design and the branding and make sure that everything is right and conveys the message you want it to before launching.
So another reason that you might be launching a new website, potentially if you're on a current platform, is certain limitations with the current platform that you're on, or improved capabilities with moving to a new platform. This screenshot shows a very specific example of that. So we're looking at Magento here, which I'm sure a lot of you know. We at Something Digital do a lot of work with. And what we're looking at on the left is the checkout page from Magento 1. And what we're looking at on the right is the checkout page from Magento 2. And Magento in Magento 2, the checkout process has been greatly simplified. So you can see this on the right if you look at that where the check mark is that says shipping, and then you see a step 2 that says review and payment. Magento 2 has made checkout into just a two-step process. Magento 1, which is on the left, you can see you first have to select your checkout method, which means are you a guest or are you a registered user? You have a billing information screen that we're focused in on there. And if you actually scroll down, there's six steps involved with going through this checkout. So the platform has improved and has added new capabilities and features with Magento 2, and you may be looking to launch a new website to realize those features. There are some other things aside from this case study that also could be driving factors here. For example, you might not be doing e-commerce currently. You might have a brochure type of a website and you're looking to add e-commerce functionality and need to rebuild your website to facilitate that. You may be looking to expand from only doing B2C to doing B2B and need a platform that can support what you're looking to do B2B-wise. And you may be running on a platform that is a software as a service platform, and as a result, it is limiting you, and be looking for an on-premise solution that you host yourself and have full control over. So there are many different reasons from a platform standpoint why you also may be looking to launch a new website. So we've talked about why you should launch a new website. The next thing we're going to talk about are some reasons why you shouldn't launch a new site. So the first one of those is that you are viewing your new website as a quick fix for some issue that you're having. We've had discussions like this with clients before. They have issues with their current site, and they think that by rebuilding a new website, all those problems are going to go away, and it's going to be a quick and painless, easy process. The reality of that is that it may fix some of your problems, but when you launch your new website, you may have some other new problems as a result of it that you're going to need to deal with. So it's not a quick fix for issues that you're having. It's something that needs a lot of planning, and you need to acknowledge this is going to be a big change for you, and be ready to handle things that may come up.
You should also not launch a new website if you don't have any clear goals in place. If someone asks you, hey, why are you building a new website? And you just kind of give them a blank stare, you probably are not in a position to launch a new site. So many times we hear from clients that they want to launch a new site, maybe because the CEO or somebody high up in their company says that the old one is outdated. But really, this isn't a good enough reason to launch a new site. You can't just say, well, I don't like my current site, or my current site isn't up to date. You really need to have a clear idea and clearly set goals of things that you want to accomplish with a new site. You should have a clear idea of the big problems on the current site. Are there things that, through looking at the analytics, you've determined that users maybe don't like or potentially have issues with? Where are the pain points on your current site? You should know all of this stuff before you decide to start a new venture and launch a brand new site. And you should also have a clear idea of how that new site is going to fix and how it might even hinder some other aspects on the site. So you should really take stock of your current situation and clearly outline the reasons why you want to launch a new site and what you expect to gain out of it.
Another issue that we've seen before is not having the proper resources in place to run the site and operate it once it goes live. We're going to go into a little bit more depth when we go into the what to expect section about who those resources are and what responsibilities need to be filled. But going back to the example of maybe you have a a brochure site and you're looking to break into e-commerce, you need to make sure that you understand what the team that you need to have in place to support that is going to take, and that you are in a position to have that team available. If you don't have the right team available to be running that website for you, it's not going to be a success.
So now that we've gone over some reasons of why you should not launch a new site, we want to delve into what you can actually expect when you've made the decision to launch the new site and you're preparing to do so. Let's imagine that you've worked really hard and now you're ready to launch your beautiful new site that you really love. We want to give you a sense of what's next and what your expectations should look like. So first of all, and this is a not so fun one, but we want to warn you that you should anticipate anywhere from a 5 to 10% decrease in organic search traffic after you launch your new site. When you see this, you might feel a little bit panicked. Why is my traffic dipping? What did I do wrong? But you should know that this is normal and it's something that you can anticipate seeing for the first few months after you launch the new site. Reasons for this are that Google needs time to reevaluate your trust score and also to register any new 301s or completely new links that you may have in place. Maybe your sitemap location has changed. Maybe you've just submitted a new one to Search Console. Google needs time to process all of that information. Even if you do everything right, there also might be some 404s with your new site that you'll need to work through the first couple of months post-launch. So these are all things that can kind of contribute to the organic traffic drop and that you should keep in mind. And if you are concerned about this and you have time and resources and money, you should definitely consider increasing any paid marketing efforts that you have going on in order to combat this drop. So that's something we definitely suggest doing if you are able to.
So this is the continuation of missing resources. What we're looking at here is a list of the things that you will need to operate an e-commerce business. A lot of our clients are running e-commerce, so that's what we're going to take a look at here. So starting if we're looking at this like it's a clock and we start with e-com director, there needs to be a person in place who owns the e-com operation and is kind of overseeing everything that's going on and making the decisions about what's going to be happening, prioritizing the work and driving the success. That would typically be an e-com director position, and that really needs to be in place for your e-com website to be running smoothly. Obviously, they can't be doing everything themselves, so they're going to need a team behind them to get done all the work that needs to happen on the site, and that's the rest of what we're looking at here. So another responsibility that is typically required for a successful e-com business is a merchandiser. What the merchandiser will be doing for you is they're in charge of the products that are on your website. So they're in charge of getting new products onto your website. They're in charge of getting them into the appropriate categories, making sure that the categories are well structured for your users. So keeping track of what products are your best sellers, adjusting that if there's seasonality and things like that that are impacting how you want to merchandise your products. Their life and their world is about the products on the website. Another thing that you'll need is somebody to do graphic design for you. So as you're building out these new categories and new landing pages and emails and banner ads and all these different things that are going to be part of your website, somebody needs to be building out the visual assets. So the designs that are going into those emails, the banners that are going onto landing pages, all these things need to be built out regularly, and you're going to need somebody who has some design chops to be doing that for you. Another thing that you'll typically want to have is a content strategist. So what their responsibility is publishing content to your website. Content is, you know, Lindsay's talking about SEO, and content is really critical to ranking high in Google. So the way that Google actually perceives and trusts your website is based on the number of other websites that are linking to it. And the way to get those links is to have good content that people want to come and read. It can also be a strategy to cross-sell users to different products based on that content. So you need to be having ongoing efforts to put out, publish new content and curate things on your website. And that's going to be the content strategist's world. The next one is arguably the most important thing of anything here is customer service. So you're going to have customers on your website and they're going to be buying things and they're probably going to have some questions. You know, maybe they didn't like the thing that they got and they want to return it. Maybe, you know, there were issues with the shipping carrier and they're trying to figure out where is this thing. Maybe they have questions about the product before they buy it. This is all, you know, critical, and you need to have a team in place to field those questions and answer them. And you know, this is probably the most important thing that we're looking at here. Digital marketer or digital marketing. So somebody on the website, a team, maybe a person that is responsible for the marketing activities. So you're probably you may be doing things like paid search using a platform like AdWords. You may be doing social advertising. You may be doing different types of email marketing. You probably have a very rich mix of marketing activities that are driving users to your site, new users and return users. And somebody who owns that piece of the work, a digital marketer, is also a critical thing to be having. And finally, you probably will need some additional vendors to help out with things. Some of our clients do have in-house technical teams, but typically they don't. Typically they will engage the strategic engagement group at Something Digital. As I said in the beginning, that's the team that I am leading the developers of. And you're going to need a technical team to, you know, if the customer service gets a call and there's an issue on the website, you're going to need a technical person to go take a look and try and troubleshoot that. If the digital marketing person wants to add, you know, a new marketing integration, you'll need a tech team to work on that. So lots of different things that team is going to need to help you out with. And it's not only a tech team, you may also have, you know, some of these additional roles like the digital marketing person may be supplemented by an outside agency as well. So it's forming that mix to kind of cover this spectrum of roles and responsibilities that we're looking at here.
So another thing we want to talk about is what you can expect to see with returning users. And one of the things that you might experience after launching your new site is a dip in conversion rate or CVR for your returning user groups. I don't want to sound ageist, but especially if you have a really devoted core group of returning users who are in an older demographic, they might have some issues getting used to the new changes on your site. And even if they aren't, even if they're younger, they still just might be really used to the way that you had things. And even though maybe there were problems, it still just will take some time for them to get used to the new experience. So if you've launched a new site and you've noticed this returning user conversion rate dip, again, don't panic. This is relatively normal. It's something that happens very frequently. And there are some things you can do to figure out what's going on and also to combat any problems that people might be having. So the first thing that we recommend you do is conduct some user testing. And if you are in the position, maybe you're listening to this webinar and you're in the position where you're still in the planning stages of launching your new site, we would recommend that you put aside some budget for user testing so that after the site launches, you are in a position to actually do that. A lot of people write it off, but it's really, really helpful. And it's relatively inexpensive if you're doing it through a platform like usertesting.com. So let's say you're noticing that users are getting stuck at the second step of your checkout. You've changed your checkout and users seem to be having some issues with it. You can set up a bunch of tests on usertesting.com to get people to go through that workflow and document what they might be having issues with or what they might find odd. And it can be really helpful for you to kind of get a sense of what's happening with your user base without directly interacting with them. So along with user testing, we also recommend that you do some research. Get somebody on your team if you have a digital strategist, or maybe even if you have a digital marketing agency, you could get them to do some research into that conversion rate dip and really get a better sense of if there are specific pages users are having issues with. Maybe it's specific buttons or a new outline change on your site. Just get a better sense of what might actually be happening. And another thing we would say is that you really want to make sure that, if there is a potential issue on the site, that it is an actual issue, it's an actual problem, and it's not just some learning curve. You got to, keep in mind that it'll just potentially take users time to get used to certain features. They might not even be problematic. It might just be that you need to wait a couple of months for people to get used to how things are on the site. And if you've gone through all of those steps and you're still not really sure what's going on, you can't tell if it's real problems or if it's learning curve, you could always consider putting together and sending customers a survey to ask them about the new website. So these are all some things that you can do. One other thing we would suggest is after new site launch, always monitor your feedback on social media. That's another good place where you can sometimes get free advice and suggestions from your user base. So if you take all of those steps into consideration, you should be able to figure out what's going on and determine how best to deal with it.
So going back to that internal team of people that you're going to have working on this new website, whether you are, you haven't had a website before and you're just starting out with this, or whether you were on a different platform before and you're moving onto a new platform, you can expect that after you launch your new website, that it's going to take that internal team, kind of similar to your user base, a little while to get acclimated to this new platform and understand how things work. So again, a couple areas that this touches: content management. You'll have a website, there will be content on it, there'll be pages and different blocks of content in different areas, and the team that's in charge of managing that will need to understand where that lives in the admin panel of the tool that you're using, how to use the different tools within the admin panel to manage that content. So if we go back to the Magento example, in Magento 2, a new tool called Bluefoot was introduced, which is a page builder, kind of a drag and drop interface. It's, going back to platform enhancements, it's actually a great platform enhancement that was added in Magento 2, but it's a new tool and it's something that you need to learn how to use. Catalog management. So, going back to that merchandiser who needs to get product onto the website, that process may change and there may be a learning curve involved in how do I get products? I need to get this new set of products onto the website. How do I get them on there? It may take that person a little while after the website launches to really fully get comfortable with that process. Customer service, going back to, the customer that calls and wants to return their product or wants to know what's going on to it. There may be a little bit of acclimation to the new platform to understand how do I create a refund? How do I figure out what's going on with an order? How does this all work? There may be some training and learning that needs to happen there as well. Your marketer may be looking to set up different types of promotions on your website if you're doing e-com. So maybe they want to do a buy one, get one offer or different types of offers. Maybe it only applies to a certain set of products, or there are different conditions that need to be met. Maybe there's a minimum order amount, and learning the tools that are available to configure those kind of things as well may require a little bit of learning and adjustment after the website launches. So typically during the build process and before the website goes live, there will be some learning that's happening and training with the platform. But I always find that, you know, it's not until you're in the real world now and you have real users and real issues going on that all that training you did helped, but, you know, there's definitely some learning that's going to need to happen now that everything is real. So going back to that technical team that you want to have supporting you, you definitely want to have a team engaged to help out with understanding how to do these things and giving you recommendations and how do I create a refund? Okay, this is where you go. These are the gotchas and the caveats to it. You definitely want to have a team on hand that can help you out with those things.
Another common thing that we've run into with clients is issues with ranking and questions about 301s. So oftentimes we will launch a new site and a client will come back to us and they'll say, hey, if all of my 301s are implemented in the right way, then why am I seeing a small dip in rankings for these top pages or these URLs, these keywords? And what we always tell them is that 301s are great and they're definitely the best way to deal with a new URL that you need to direct users to, but they do only pass 90 to 99% of the old links ranking. So even if you have them in place, they're all working correctly, you're still not going to see an immediate pass in link juice for those new links. Just like with everything else, it's going to take Google some time to register these, to update your trust score, and to get you to a place where you were before. So one thing we always say is that after a site launch, you really should monitor your top keywords and pages, keep track of them over time. There are a lot of tools out there that can help you do this. You could use Authority Labs, you could use Moz, you could use SEMrush. There are a bunch of them out there. Look into it and figure out which one is best for you and most cost effective and get that in place. And then again, if you've noticed a couple of top keywords or top pages where your rankings have maybe dipped a little bit after launch, we suggest you go through and identify them and then supplement with paid search. So if you've noticed a couple of keywords where you've dipped that are typically really important for you and provide good conversion rate, go ahead and up your paid search spend on those keywords. So just watch things over time, and you should start to see your traffic and your rankings normalize as the new site has been live for a longer period.
This is a bit of a specific area that to look at after your site goes live, but it's one that we've seen issues on with quite a few of our clients. Typically, when we're rolling out an e-commerce platform, it's integrated with some other systems. When an order comes in, most of our clients aren't handling the whole thing within that e-commerce platform. You know, going into the warehouse, figuring out which items need to be picked, putting them into the box. It's typically integrated with another system where the order information gets sent to, and then vice versa when a shipment gets created on that order, and an update comes from that system to the e-commerce platform to say, notify the customer and send them an email with their tracking number. These integrations, we write integration specifications. We or another partner would do this type of a work when building out these new integrations. And obviously testing is done prior to the go live. But once you start to get into the real world again, there are different use cases that may occur that for whatever reason were not tested. It's hard to know every variant of thing that's going to happen in the real world. So we talked about discounts and promotions and things like that. We have seen issues in the past where the way that discounts or promotions get basically spread across order items doesn't jive with external accounting systems. We've seen weird things in the past where product names or even, you know, customer first names or last names or street names exceed a certain length. And when that data gets to an external system, it breaks because of those type of limitations. Another thing worth noting about once your site goes live is that you're going to start to receive real-world order volumes, and things can break when they go under stress. So you should also anticipate that issues may come up there. Similar to line length, there's also, you know, sometimes different types of special characters or punctuation marks that sometimes make their way into data that goes between systems that can sometimes break them. So there are all different kinds of things that can break these integrations and these import and exports that happen between different systems. And so the recommendation for what to do about this is obviously to test this thoroughly, as I had said, prior to go launch, but to acknowledge and understand and be prepared that there are probably going to be some issues with these processes after your site goes live, and you need to be in a position to, when they do come in, to have the resources lined up to investigate them and implement fixes as needed for these types of issues that might come up.
And finally, one other potential issue that you could deal with from an SEO standpoint is sort of specific, like Max's previous slide, but it is something that we see clients run into occasionally. We dealt with this with a client not that long ago. They had decided that with their new site launch, they were going to also change their domain to something completely different. And this is one of those SEO things that can cause a lot of problems if not done correctly. It's not something that you should ever just go into with your own internal team and no specified SEO agency or person to sort of monitor and take all of the necessary precautions to make sure that things go as expected. So we would say that if you are preparing to do a domain change as your new site launches, if possible, you should get an SEO team or an SEO dedicated person in place to help you with this. But if you have not done that and you have now launched a new site with a brand new domain, you might be dealing with some serious SEO repercussions. And this is one of those areas where it could take a really long time for you to bounce back if you haven't taken all the steps necessary to ensure that your traffic hasn't dropped off a lot. You might be in a position where you're noticing significant dips that could last for up to a year. So if you find yourself in this position, we would say that you would be best off definitely going through all of the preliminary steps, making sure that you've submitted a change of address to Google, making sure that your sitemap is updated, making sure that you've put in your 301s. You're going to want to do extensive link testing on your new site. And if you've done all of that and you're still having issues even up to a year later, this might be an area where you need to, like I said, engage an SEO agency or engage a dedicated SEO person to help you get your domain authority back up to where it was and to account for some of the organic traffic dips that you've experienced. So this is one thing to watch out for.
Here we're kind of zooming out from the specific example that I gave with import-export processes and talking just more generally about edge cases or different things that weren't properly tested for whatever reason or didn't get tested. A good partner when you're launching a new website will obviously be testing more than the quote-unquote happy paths on your website. But there are so many different permutations of journeys that a user may take on your website. And inevitably, there are going to be different paths that people take that weren't tested and may have issues. So real world shopping cart sizes, real world user paths, real world traffic. In terms of traffic specifically, So, there may be issues that come up with different functionality related to performance when it comes into real world traffic conditions. So I can think of one specific example where there was some code that was, it was renaming images in order to basically automatically generate the image name for SEO purposes. And the way it was doing it was not, it wasn't detected during the build process prior to launch, but once it did get out into the wild, it was detected that this code was actually kind of intensive on the CPU, and we had to remediate it and fix it in an alternate way. So there may be issues that come up like that after your site goes live as well. So the recommendation here, again, is kind of similar to the recommendation that we saw previously, but just acknowledge that when your site does go live, there are probably going to be some issues. That kind of goes back to the magical fix thing. Your new site is going to have some issues that are going to need to be fixed, and to be in a position to investigate and implement fixes for those after your site does go live. So that kind of covers the content of this talk. We took a look at reasons that you would want to launch a new site, some reasons not to launch a new website, and also the things that you can expect when you do launch a new website. So just to kind of wrap things up, and we're going to see if anybody does have any questions after this, but just to kind of sum up kind of the main points and takeaways from this talk, we're just going to go through some conclusions. So first of all, before you launch a new site, identify clear goals and strategies for success. Lindsay kind of spoke about this when we talked about reasons not to launch a new website, is that you don't have a goal or something that you're, there's not a problem that you're trying to solve with this. It's just a feeling of, I feel like we need a new website, but there's nothing specific that I'm looking to get out of it. Make sure that you're not doing that, and when you are launching a new website, that you do have specific goals, and also that if you've watched this webinar, you're in a good position because you've seen some of the issues that can come up, and we've presented a bunch of recommendations, but be ready to implement those strategies to make sure that your website launch is a success.
We also talked about how you should not just think that launching a new site is going to fix all of your problems. We've outlined many different problems that you can have after launch, and also we've outlined some reasons why you should not launch a new site, with this being one of them. So don't go into it just thinking that you'll launch the site and everything will be fine. You're inevitably going to run into some issues. You're going to have some kinks to work out. That's all totally normal. Don't panic. You will get through it. And if you do your due diligence, you will see good results from your new website in no time.
And so lastly, we had talked specifically about the integration points with import and export of data and some issues that you might run into there. And also just from a general standpoint, once you start to get real user traffic, some gaps and things that may be missed during the testing process and the need to be able to be in a position to remediate those after you go live. So the conclusion here is just to be prepared that there will be issues that are going to come up once you launch a new website, and be prepared to be able to fix those. And we would say to plan for probably about a 90-day adjustment period when your website does go live. And that's kind of accounts for everything that we've talked about here, with training issues, different things like redirects, the 301s that we cover, to prepare for kind of a buffer window to adjust and get ready for your new platform. So that kind of concludes what we had to present to you guys today. If there are any questions from the audience, we are happy to answer them. All right, I guess there are no questions, but I want to thank everybody who did attend this, and I hope you got something out of it. If you want to chat with either of us further, we'd be happy to answer questions not directly in response to this, but through a separate channel. These are both of our phone numbers and email addresses. You can contact Lindsay or myself there. We'd love to hear from you. And again, thanks for attending.